So now we're going to talk about sessions. So we got to keep cookies and sessions separate. That's the thing I told you got to worry about. And so cookies are a little tiny key value store, key value in the browser, right? And the PHP can send them, and then the browser sends them back on all future requests. And so that's what cookies are. They're small, they're not too many of them, but they're very, very useful. So one of the things that we use cookies for are sessions. So what we do is when we see a session is often a particularly named cookie, you'll see them in a bit, and we see, this browser we've seen for the first time, and so we pick a large random number, 42, and then we send the cookie back and say your number is 42, and at the same time we create a little file somewhere, or a piece of memory, or a piece of a database, or something, for that number. So we have this connection between the browser's number and a server, a number of some piece of data on the server. And so now what we do when we get a new request coming in, we look at the cookie and then we grab that. And so we pull the session data in. So the cookie comes in, but we also pull the session data in. And this is another set of key value pairs that you can have pulling that data in. And then if there's another browser, right, comes in, we say, oh, welcome new browser from a different country or whatever. We'll pick a new number and send you out and mark you as browser 6F. And then from that point on, 6F comes in, but then when it comes in, the cookie comes in, but we also pull the session data. And then inside your program, you can change the session data and it gets written back. And so what happens is as the request response cycles happen, you are reading and writing. The way we think of the session is it's just a place that you can read and write. So if you write in one request, you can read it back in the next request. And believe me, we're going to do that a whole lot. There's lots of really wonderful use cases of having some bit of data that persists across request response cycles. And that's the essence of a session, is we do that. And we use cookies as the mechanism to make that possible so that we know that one browser is this session and a different browser is this session. And so when this script runs, it knows it has data that it's stored for one browser and has data that's stored for another browser. So it's super awesome. It's just awesome. So we often create sessions right away when we first meet them, but first we have to send the cookie, pick the number, send the cookie, and away we go. And the session identifier is usually this really, really large random number that is encoded in hexadecimal, like all hexadecimal is, it's like 0 through 9 and A through F, and it's representing in a single character position the numbers 0 through 15 with only one character. And so it's a kind of a compressed form of numbers, and we make them long because we want session identifiers to be a relatively large randomly selected number, because literally if you can guess the session identifier of someone else's session, you can sort of break into their session. Okay, and so part of the it's security by if you know you can't hide it, but this really large number, trillions of numbers, you know, it's so it's hard to guess. Now, if you can sort of sneak over somebody's computer and grab their session, maybe, but that's usually not. There are way better ways to break into people's accounts than catching them in a coffee shop when they go to the bathroom and going and logging into their computer and pulling their session out. There are way better ways to do that, because one thing, you have to be in the same coffee shop. Or maybe you put crappy software on their computer, but whatever. Session identifiers are large random numbers. Server encounters new browser, no session cookie, simply picks a large random number, sends it out a session cookie, and then creates a file that corresponds to that large random number. And the file, the session file, is the data that only the application can change. The cookie data belongs to the user, but the session data belongs to the application. And unless there's a bug in the application, the user cannot change the session data. And so you can just go to pretty much any old site. In this case, you can go to my Sugi page and you can look at the first page. You got to kind of open it and look at the first page, and then you will see a session cookie. And then in this case, it's Sugi is a PHP application and it sets a PHP session cookie. And the PHP sesh ID, you're going to see a bunch of those, and you may have been seeing them in your browser as well, because if you're using the autograder, you'll see that it uses cookieless sessions, and it has to protect itself a different way because it's using cookieless sections. Sessions don't end up on the, you can't see, you don't see them because the cookie's kind of this hidden thing. And so PHP Sesh ID, you can even change that name inside PHP, but the default is PHP Sesh ID. So you go to most sites, you look at your cookies, and if it says PHP Sesh ID, it's like, well, that must be a PHP application because it's setting the session for me. So if we take a look at this picture, as I've sort of described, we are marking browsers. So now what we have is different browsers, right? Different people's browsers. And we give them each a little different mark. We pick a random number. And then what we do is we have a corresponding bit of data on the server that allow us to store keys and values in here. KV, keys and values, X equals 2, X equals 4. Whatever it is we want to store, and then when this browser finally comes into us, we reassociate the session, and then we know that this particular browser, we set X equals 4 the previous time we talked to them, okay? And so that's the idea, that's the basic code. I mean, that's the basic structure of where the data lives. Now, in PHP, we have to call session underscore start to say, hey, PHP, this script that we're running right now wants to use sessions. And so you tend to put that at early part of nearly all of your scripts, session start. And once session start has run, then the global array dollar underscore session exists. And so it's a super global like dollar get, dollar cookies, and dollar session. So dollar session is not the cookie data, but to find dollar session, it has to look at cookie data, right? And so, and the cool thing about dollar session is you can put it on the right side or the left side of an assignment statement, because if you modify session at the end, it stores that back on disk. And so you can think of the session variable as a variable that lives from request response cycle to request response cycle, right? So here comes a browser, you know, and it writes something into session and it stores it. And then the response goes back, time passes. And then it comes in. Now this was a post, there's dollar post, but after this response is sent, dollar post, that dollar post is gone. But you wrote something into the session. Now here it comes again on a get request, and there's a dollar get variable, but then the session data comes up, and so the session data you stored here comes back for this later request. This is time passing, right? And so, you know, this one stores something else in session and then sends the response. The dollar get data doesn't exist, okay? And then more time passes, browser hits it again, in comes a post request that's all new, but then it pulls the session data out, and then it does something, and the session data is rewritten, and then the response goes, again, time passes, this post data is long gone, the post and the get are ephemeral, they only exist for the period of that request response cycle, but whatever you store in session comes back for the next request response cycle. So you tend to like say, oh, I'll store this at the end of this response, and then I'll be able to grab it at the beginning of it. And we do that all the time. It's really pretty cool how that works. Pretty darn cool how that works. So if you really want to know something about your sessions, you can actually go into your PHP info and you can look for the key session underscore save path. And then you can go into a folder on your XAMPP or your MAMP. It'll be somewhere on your hard drive. And you can actually cruise down and look at that stuff. And you will see a bunch of files. By default, you can store this stuff all kinds of places, and production sites don't store them in files. Big production sites tend to store them in fancier Redis or Memcache or some other fancy thing. But in the default, and the way we're running for our development and for small to moderate sites, they just store them on disk. So they're little disk files, and you can take a look at them, and you can see that they are named ses underscore exactly the same as that big session ID that's in the cookie. And so you can figure out by looking at your cookie and looking at the name of the file, and you can actually open your session data. Now, this is a file on server. You can only do this on the server. The user can't do this. The user can see their cookie. They can't see their session. If you open it, don't write it, or you can throw them away, but you can kind of see, if you look carefully, it's just some key values. But some of these things that are in here are, some of those things that are in this are arrays, and so they kind of have a serialized version of those arrays. Or it's just strings, and so this is not something you're supposed to look at, but you can kind of see roughly the kind of stuff that's in there in those files. And some people get good at reading this, and they actually debug applications by like, what? Oh, what's wrong? What ended up in that session? And some people go actually look at this stuff. But I'm just showing it to emphasize that these session bits are sitting on disk. So in PHP, the way we do this is we say session start. Now, session start does a couple of things. It does whatever is necessary to get the session started. So If there's no cookie, session start does a lot more than if there is a cookie. If there is no cookie, session start picks a session identifier, creates the session on disk, sends the cookie back, and then creates the dollar session variable, which you can then use. Okay, so let's go through that again. When there is no session cookie, it picks a random number, makes a session file, sets the session cookie, and creates the dollar underscore session variable. Okay, if there is a cookie, it looks and it finds the file, it reads the file, and sets the dollar session. The one thing you know is after session underscore start, as long as you do it before any output has been sent, you will have the dollar underscore session will be set. So this is make it, set it, find it, however you got to do it, get me a dollar underscore session. Okay, so that's what it does. And you put this way toward the top of your code, maybe the first line, maybe the second line, but you don't certainly put this after any output. Session destroy effectively deletes all the keys in the session. And so here's a little bit of code. It's right now just to demonstrate how session works. It's not particularly intuitive, or it doesn't really solve a complex problem. So here we go, right? Session start, first line, first executable line. You see I'm using kind of my model view controller pattern. I'm doing all kind of silent stuff up here, although I am sending echoes out, so it's kind of a little not perfect. So session start basically guarantees that $session, a new super global, exists, okay? And I can say it's a key value, it's just an array. If is set session sub value, if it's not, then I'm going to print out that session is empty and set it to zero. So the key to session is you can have it on the left-hand side of an assignment statement. Super awesome. That is, without any further effort on your part, writing that key value onto the disk. And if you want to look at this and run this code on your own computer, you can go see the little disk file and you'll see, oh, there's a value and it's got a zero in it. Cool. So if it's not set, I set it to zero. And then else if the value is less than 3, then I go pull the old one out and add 1 to it and send it back. So it's going to be 0 first, then it's going to be 1, then it's going to be 2, then it's going to be... But if it's then 3, then it's going to come to here. So if the session value is greater than 3, this will be false and it'll come to here. Then it'll do a session destroy and then a session restart in a sense. And then away we go and print that out. And all I do with this little click me is click, click, click. There's a couple things you can do. You can echo the session ID, and that's showing that big random number. And then it's kind of often that you do just a print R of dollar underscore session. So you're like, what the heck's in my session? Because a lot of your code will be putting stuff into session and taking stuff out of session. So here's how that code runs. The first time it, it's using pizza, not value, but you get the idea. So it's using pizza as the key on this particular one. And so the session is empty and we set it to 0. Then we click it again. The next time you click it, the session is 1. Come on. All right, the next time you click it, the session is 1, then the session is 2, then the session is 3, and then it just restarts the session and there's nothing in it, but then the next time you click, it'll go back and do the same thing. So you get the basic idea. So this code uses pizza instead of value in this little bit of code. So it's pretty much the same as that. Okay? Okay, so one last small topic is sessions without cookies. Now, if you've been using my autograder, you have been seeing sessions without cookies, and I'll just say that they're trickier, and we'll talk about that when we get back to sessions without cookies.